Здравствуйте, good morning, good day, good afternoon, good night. My presentation will be in English, because I don't know how to say many things in Russian. Моя презентация будет по-английски, потому что я просто не знаю, как по-русски многие вещи сказать. I want to thanks, first of all, to the organizer of the conference. This is very difficult in the pandemic, COVID pandemic, to organize this hybrid conference. Я хочу поблагодарить организаторов конференции, потому что я понимаю, как сложно было организовать эту конференцию гибридную во время ковидной пандемии. I also want to thank Irina, thanks a lot for moderating this session, and I think you are a moderator, not me. Thanks a lot for doing this work. Спасибо большое, Ирина, за модерацию этой сессии, поскольку я считаю, что вы делаете работу, а не я. Я очень вам благодарен за это. И я хотел бы тоже попросить, чтобы я мог, я не знаю, как это сказать, shared screen. And just a sec. Okay.
Так, сейчас так. Сделают. Сейчас будет презентация. Все. Сейчас пойдет.
Сейчас показывает.
Показывает.
Все видно. Пропало.
А? Пропало, но сейчас вернут. Ага. Что-то не получается.
Кони дуют. Можно ага. Сделать еще раз.
Еще ага, раз. Сейчас попробую еще раз. Ага.
Вот.
Видно?
Да, мы видим.
Ага. Похоже, что я не могу делать это в режиме слайдов, но ничего.
F5 можно нажать.
Okay, let's keep it as it is. It looks like I cannot do it in the slide regime for some reason, but it's fine. So my presentation is, first of all, I want to tell you that I'm not a philologist. I come from education, and I'm trying to, like my big, huge project is to translate Bakhtinian philosophical ideas and first of all, ideas of dialogism into education and see what will happen. Whether or not it's a good project or not, it's still a good question. So this is actually part of this big question and big project. What I want to kind of offer to you, it's more like my questions rather than something I want to tell something definitive I want to tell. So my project is, as you see, the educational regime of Bakhtinian dialogue, образовательный режим бахтинского диалога. So what's the project is about? I'm trying to figure out, like, what's Bakhtinian dialogue in my reading of that, and what kind of education, it kind of fantasize, what kind of education it might inspire if we try to promote that type of dialogue. And also I want to ask a question, is it even possible and even desirable? And that's all of these questions that I want to promote. So, oops. I want to start with setting the problem. What's the problem is? And I want to remind you that when Bakhtin wanted to bring an example of excessive monologism, he usually brings an example of education, which is interesting. So the kind of the worst case scenario for excessive monologism, it's example of the practice of education. And this is his one of his quotes that really attracts my attention. In essence, excessive monologism, knows only a single mode of cognitive interaction among consciousness. Someone who knows and possesses the truth instructs someone who is ignorant of it and in error. That is the interaction of a teacher and a pupil, which it follows can be only a pedagogical exchange. You can see I a little bit edited Bakhtin because just it makes more sense for me to understand that. And I apologize for some people who might object my editing of Bakhtin. Some Bakhtinian educationalists, people who actually dialogic educationists, who are attracted to the notion of dialogue and specifically Bakhtinian notion of dialogue, they have there are several attractions they have in Bakhtinian dialogue, and some of these attractions are like there is a lot of people say, well, education is about meaning making. Which is, by the way, believe it or not, it's kind of questionable in education. But nevertheless, some people think, some educationalists think that it's based on the meaning making. And Bakhtin claims that meaning making is a dialogic process. That's one of the attraction. Another attraction is coming more like that on the level, on the quality of human interaction. And or human relations, better to say, that like what in order for things to become human, they should be dialogized. And this is another attraction of some educationalists to Bakhtinian dialogue. Another attraction is about depthness of the educational depthness that involved. Unfinalizing and critical or testing ideas. And this is like the critical focus that also interesting for some educationalists. Another attraction is that to make education actually full of voices, heteroglossia, heterodiskursia, разноречия. This is how I translate разноречия, heterodiskursia. And also ontological, that attraction that education should be ontological. And again, this is they can kind of get inspired from Bakhtin. And maybe some other attractions. I just want to list a few. That's why educators are attracted to this notion of the dialogue. So the question becomes, how to promote a Bakhtinian dialogue, even if it's possible or undesirable. Of course, one answer to this question, why even we need to promote that? Dialogue will happen anyway, in any conditions, even in very in the condition of this excessive monologism, dialogue can happen. But my answer to this kind of counter-argument is that, of course, like metaphorically speaking, any plant can develop its, can get through the cracks of the, on the asphalt or beton or whatever, concrete. But it doesn't mean that in order to create a garden, we should cover the soil with the asphalt on, or cement. It's not a good idea of doing the garden. So it's reverse, it's to think about what kind of soil, what kind of nurturing should be promoted in order to for plants to blossom. So that's my project is about. Now, looking at my title of my presentation, I see a lot of contradictions. Like for example, regime. Regime is a kind of organization of politics in this context. And the notion of dialogue may be not necessarily compatible with the notion of politics, because politics is about like legitimacy of imposition of actions and ideas and values on other people. And this is not necessarily what a dialogue, especially Bakhtinian dialogue, is kind of interested in. So that's one contradiction. Another contradiction, Bakhtinian dialogue and education. I almost more than 10 years ago, I raised that question whether or not education is compatible with Bakhtinian dialogue. By the way, by Bakhtinian dialogue in general, and I will talk about it more, I understand more Bakhtin's analysis of dialogue among characters of Dostoevsky's characters in his polyphonic novels. This is heuristic what Bakhtinian dialogue is in this particular case. So another contradiction is in this kind of title, some educators say that education has nothing to do with politics. And this is more coming from Enlightenment, that education should be moved away from politics and should be mostly be about internally persuasive discourse rather than any politics of regime. And I acknowledge all this contradiction, and I think they are there. And nevertheless, I say that while being there, they may be not only turning things apart, but creating a very interesting kind of field. So while full of the tensions, I think nevertheless, they can or might consider to be together, education, politics, and Bakhtinian dialogue in this case. And this is, we're talking about education politics, not necessarily some other politics outside of that. So saying on that, I want to say that I want to focus like, what does it mean Bakhtinian dialogue for me? And I understand that Bakhtinian dialogue could be understood very differently by different people. But this is, I kind of start thinking about, this is my five attraction, at least for now, at this particular moment. And I understand that some other people might find other attractors in Bakhtinian dialogue, what defined for them Bakhtinian dialogue. And again, I'm focused on the dialogue among Dostoevsky characters in his polyphonic novel. So the first one is a plurality of unmerchable consciousness with equal rights. And this is how Bakhtin almost starts his book on Dostoevsky with this notion. And let me again, unfortunately, I cannot jump. Can I jump on that? Yeah, I can. Okay. I don't know if you can see that well. So this is a famous, or at least for me, very important quote from Bakhtin on page 6 of his book in English version. So it's very, very beginning. He says that a plurality of independent and unmerged voices and consciousnesses, a genuine polyphony of a full valid voices is in the fact the chief characteristic of Dostoevsky's novels. What unfolds in his works is not multitude of characters and fates in a single objective world, illuminated by a single authorial consciousness, rather a plurality of consciousness with equal rights, and each with its own world, combined but are not merged in the unity of the event. And so I put this bold, it's mine, italics is Bakhtin's. So I will start thinking about what does it mean rights, equal rights, and what rights specified. And I couldn't find, maybe my philological colleagues could find it, but I couldn't find direct Bakhtin unpacking this notion of rights. What kind of rights he's talking about? And I pick up at least three important rights. How I would like imagining how Bakhtin might answer to that. And of course, I don't know whether or not he would agree with me or not. So the first right is the right to be taken seriously. And this is to treat both a person of participant in dialogue seriously as a whole person and as author of particular ideas of this person. That doesn't mean that taking seriously does not mean that there is agreement about that, but it means that it represents interest in the person. Carol yesterday talked about love. I'm not sure I would put the love in that, but again, this is a difference between Carol probably and my sensitivities. But I've used the word at least deep interest in the person and the person's ideas. And I would say that this right to be taken seriously, this right of consciousness, in my view, constitutes what I called community behind that kind of make help to develop a voice of the person. Again, I know that Anna Marianovich Shane might disagree with me about that, but this is kind of where am I right now. Maybe later I will disagree with myself. So this is first important right that I think Bakhtin meant by equal rights. The second right is the right to introduce one's own interests and concerns into dialogue and to change and interrupt, remain silent, drop a topic, or leave a dialogue temporarily or entirely at any time. This is very important in my view, right, of equal consciousness is into defined what the dialogue is about and not to be a prisoner of this dialogue and to change topic and to bring different topics, which is to create разноречие, what I call heterodiscursia, into the dialogue, to bring different tensions. And also this idea that how much you want to hear from another person, when to interrupt. This is not kind of polite dialogue, how some people, in my view, you can see in Dostoevsky, interruptions are a lot, there is a lot of interruptions. There is a very interesting philosopher who is he's from Russia, but he lives in the United States, Dmitry Nikulin. He really puts this notion of interoperability when there is in the life dialogue, people have rights to interrupt each other, not, and they practice that right. And I think he picked up that from Sherba, from Russian linguist of the beginning of 20th century. So the next right is to right to disagree and remain in disagreement, or right to be misunderstood, half understood, misinterpreted, and remain unknown. This is, in my view, very important right about something what I would call opaqueness of consciousness. And this is very important principle of in my view, in my reading of Bakhtin, the consciousness are opaque, or what Bakhtin's called unmerged, but I really put a little bit further than that. They're not only unmerged, but unmergeable. So I make it a little bit stronger. Again, I don't know if Bakhtin would approve that or not. In my reading, he would. Of course, they're opaque, not 100%. They're always, it's always partially opaque, but this, but nevertheless, it's opaqueness is very essential. And that's why this Bakhtinian dialogue is very different from Enlightenment dialogue, which is temporary, when the disagreements are temporary, and when the whole dialogue is working towards consensus at the end, and productive, to be productive. The most important in a way, in Enlightenment dialogue, which is not Bakhtinian in my judgment, is about getting result and to get rid of all these misunderstandings, disagreements, breakouts, and so on and so forth, misinterpretations, to clean from them to that and to come to the solid conclusion. And this is, in my view, Enlightenment dialogue. I put number four with question marks because I invite people to think about what other rights might be, or maybe I missed, or maybe people disagree, and maybe there is alternative to these rights. So this is my first, again, let me try to, okay. No, this is not the right, okay. So this is first feature, what I would call Bakhtinian dialogue. The second one, I call this kind of authorship, and we have heard on the conference about this. I think Vladimir Lvovich Makhlin talks about yesterday about authorship. Author with unique and unpredictable voice. By the way, Carol, huge thanks for bringing Mikhail Epstein, and I just downloaded his article. I didn't read that, but I'm super excited from what you presented yesterday. Thanks a lot for that. Why it's going to the wrong place? Okay, sorry for that. I need to now find that where it might be. Sorry. Let me try one more time. Why is it going in the wrong place? No, it's wrong place. Oh. Yes. Again, another big point for me of the Bakhtinian dialogue, it's this authorship with a unique and unpredictable and uncalculable voice. So this is a quote, my favorite quote from Bakhtin. The hero interests Dostoevsky as a particular point of view on the world and on oneself, as a position enabling a person to interpret and evaluate his own self and his surrounding reality. What is important to Dostoevsky is not how a hero appears in the world, but first and foremost, how the world appears to the hero and how the hero appears to himself. This is a very important point from Bakhtinian dialogue, exactly because if you think about conventional and innovative education, this is the least important points in the education, because usually exactly whole education is not about a voice of the student and authoring, students authoring how the world appears to the student and how student appears to themselves. But it's more about either transmission of the knowledge or socialization into some practice, without much attention to the student's voice. That's why kind of it's attracted to me. And this is a primary thing about authorship. The dialogue is about authorship, about authors. And authors, not the teacher's author, it's students' authors. And that's very important. I'm going to talk about that later. Okay, moving on. Another important thing, again, in my attraction to Bakhtinian dialogue, it's about transcendence of participants' social roles, statuses, and identities in problematic, what Bakhtin called problematic dialogue. And now I'm doing, I don't trust my own links. Okay. And this is important quotes for me about that. So basically, in Bakhtin saying that when people join this dialogue, and or Dostoevsky characters join in dialogues, they kind of transcend or become almost naked from their social roles and their identities, their reputations, and so on and so forth. What Bakhtin talks about that is become a meeting of men in man, or testing man and man. And this is this is the quote from Bakhtin. In Dostoevsky's, the adventure plot is combined with the posing of profound and acute problems. And it is, in addition, placed wholly at the surface of the idea. It places a person in extraordinary positions that expose and provoke him. It connects him and makes him collide with other people under unusual, unexpected conditions, precisely for the purpose of testing the idea and the man of idea. That is for the testing the man in man, a combination of adventurism, often of the boulevard novel sort, with idea, with a with the problematic dialogue. It is meaningful and even surmounted in Dostoevsky through the constant polyphonism of his work. So for me, this is very important because in education, again, both conventional and innovative, there is so much talk about identities or demographics of the students or positioning the students in particular roles. And if you think about it, there is even two big roles, student and the teacher. And sounds like in Bakhtinian dialogue, this should be like transcendent or exploded. There should be these roles. It may be initial for engaging in Bakhtinian dialogue, but then they should disappear or diminished. Again, because this is the, finally, the dialogue, a dialogue of the people of ideas or what Bakhtin talks about, man in man or person in person, if trying to avoid sexism in English, but not necessarily in Russian. There is no sexism in that statement in Russian at all. So the next point that for me, that attraction is this deconstructive critical dialogue of the spoil sports. The word deconstructive is used a little bit different than we hear at our conference, maybe. No, this is next one, okay. But the focus is exactly what Bakhtin focused not on the positive truths or kind of constructive functions of the dialogue, but it's deconstructive because it's focusing on the testing the truths, not constructing the truths. And this has for me become very attractive. Bakhtin said that in Dostoevsky polyphonic dialogue, truth because this is kind of Morrison's Gary Morrison, and actually this is Gary Morrison's article when he as a philologist enters a field of education, and it's extremely productive in my view, and very, very important for me as an educationalist. And he talks, this is his interpretation of Bakhtinian dialogue, but in the field of the education, and he talks about that truth becomes dialogically tested and forever testable. And this is how I use the word deconstructive, about testing things, not about erasing boundaries and erasing authors and so on and so forth, like maybe Derrida and some other use the term deconstructive. But this is direct quote from Bakhtin. The most important characteristic of miniepia as a genre is the fact that it holds and its bold and unrestrained use of the fantastic and adventure is internally motivated, justified by and devoted to purely identical and philosophical end, the creation of extraordinary situations for provoking and testing of philosophical idea, a discourse, a truth, embodied in the image of the wise man, the seeker of this truth. We emphasize this the fantastic here serves not for the positive embodiment of truth, but as a mode of searching after truth, provoking it, and most important, testing it. So this is, I'm also built on the work of Anna Marjanovich Shein that talks about that in this Bakhtinian dialogue, it's what is suspended is not disbelief, it's suspended beliefs of people beliefs because they become tested. And so Anna Marjanovich Shein borrowed this term of the spoil sport from Huizinga, who studied play. And he actually talks of the spoil sport as in negative way because spoil sport destroys the play. But in Bakhtinian dialogue, the actually participants become a spoil sports for beliefs, dear beliefs for other people's beliefs and for their own dearly or dearly held beliefs. And this is, again, you can see that from my point of view, it's very important in education. And I just want to emphasize that sport is different from troll. And again, returning back to the Carol's presentation yesterday about this troll who wrote, in my view, that person is troll who wrote about Bakhtin's biography. So Spolsport is not a troll because Spolsport interested in search for the truth, unlike troll. Troll is not interested in that. And trollism is very different from, so the Spolsport is more like a dissident rather than who is interested in testing the truth. Again, returning to the, sorry for this jumping back and forward. So the kind of the final point that I want, the attraction for me is ethical ontological nature of dialogue. Again, we were talking that in this conference a lot. And again, yesterday, Carol talked about Michael Epstein, who is really put forward this try to figure out like what might be ethics from Bakhtinian point of view in opposition to Kantian ethics. So there are several points that I found in Bakhtin that can be very helpful, and that I don't know how much I need to even present them for the people who knows Bakhtin very well. But the focus is when, for example, Bakhtin talks about that he's not when idea enters Dostoevsky's novel and dialogues, it's not Platonic ideas without bodies, without without faith, without deeds, without postupok, but it's a very ethically and ontologically tense ideas. It's idea of actions and idea of responsibilities or lack of these responsibilities. And it's idea that it's about life. It's not about decontextualized, de-ontologized and in a different way. Outside of morality, outside of ethics ideas. It's exactly ideas that call for ethics and call for, and they're embedded in the people's ontology, in their life. It's the ideas are part of the people's participants' lives. Again, Bakhtin, when Bakhtin talks about voice, he talks about not only about like physicality of the voice and articulation of the voice, but it's also voice for behind which there is a fate, there is reputation. People's reputations are changed or crashed or developed. And this is part of the voice, what he talks about fate and worldview. So this is my five attractions or understanding of Bakhtinian dialogue. Now, I want to turn now, so what can be a pedagogical regime if we want to promote this Bakhtinian dialogue in my understanding? So, and I came to conclusion so far with kind of four features of this regime, pedagogical regime. This is my fantasy again. So the first thing is about understanding education, first of all, as self-education, student self-education. And this is different from conventional education and from innovative, progressive education, especially because their education, this kind of conventional and progressive education based on the idea of Kantian educational paternalism. Kant wrote in his famous article about, I think, what is enlightenment. He make a very good point that, that you know, he started very nicely that he said that the dignity, human dignity is based on autonomy and respect for human autonomy. And very quickly he turns in opposite direction because he said, well, human autonomy based basically on reason and rationalism and be acknowledgeable. And for that, you need to have education. And you can, and so before autonomy, there should be education. And this education has to be forced on people. It should be foisted education. And so he kind of articulated a very interesting point about educational paternalism. And what is paternalism? Paternalism is a limitation of humans' liberty or freedoms for their that person's sake. And I personally, nothing against paternalism, because paternalism can be helpful. For my favorite example, that my life personal was saved in South Africa because several times a completely stranger pulled me back on the part of the pathway because I'm trying to cross the road and I looked at the wrong direction because in South Africa, it's like in Great Britain, there is a wrong traffic pattern from the point of view of other traffic patterns, like in the United States or in Russia or in Western Europe or in Eastern Europe as well. So I was saved. And the last thing that when I was saved, a person behind me just violently pulled me back. By the way, it felt very violent, like somebody. And it took me few seconds to understand and what's happened, and actually thank that stranger for saving my life. The last thing that I needed is Bakhtinian dialogue, or actually any dialogue. I needed to be treated as a physical body rather than a person with agency and subjectivity or with authorship. I don't need authorship. I needed to be treated as a physical body. So this is type of paternalism, limiting my freedoms for my own sake. In this particular case, is terrific. The problem starts when we enter education, because in education, we are not acting as a physical, primary as a physical bodies or objective subjectivities. We acting as a, that's what I would claim as, or if we think that Bakhtinian dialogue should guide our education, as authors. That's why, from my point of view, the Kantian educational paternalism is anti-educational. And that's why education should be a self-education, which means that the students will define whether or not, what's the purpose of education, whether to involve in education, what to study, how to study, with whom, where, when, and so on and so forth, how it's organized. This doesn't mean necessarily, and this is, I'm moving to the second point. I recently considered different forms of self-education, and I came to conclusion, looking at different forms, that there are at least five of them. And I think I'm jumping, yeah. So five types of the self-education. One and most common things that comes to mind when you hear the word self-education is autodidact. It's which based dialogue with the self and dialogue with the text or media. So the person basically studying without a life other people, without other people. I mean life people. Of course, a person studied can study with mediated people, like through the texts or media or something else, and in dialogue with themselves. Another type of self-education is simdidact. Didact means directed. And simdidact means studying with other people who are equal to the students. So studying with other students. And the other type is autodidact with advisement. So there is a person who can provide advice when a student asks for that advice. And again, since it's self-education, there is a recognition that student can do with this advice whatever they want. It's really advice. It's not an order masquerading as advice. The next one, it's ID goes deduct. I don't know if you pronounce this Greek word correctly. It's kind of it's what we consider to be teaching. It's education with a teacher. And in self-education, it is conditional teacher in the way that the student trusts the teacher organize education for them and provide guidance, but it's on the student's terms. At any time, student can actually break from the teacher, and it's very legitimate, and or demand some difference, adjustment in that guidance or curriculum or whatever, or aspects. In a way, the student's the final authority. I recently developed a paper about teacher's fiduciary duty to the student in this type of education. And the, oops, I misspell. Oops, now I can't okay. And the final one is very bizarre form of self-education. It's what I call auto-paternalism. And when the students demand kind of pushing to from the teacher or somebody else to push them to study. And I found this, it's almost if you think about, this is metaphorical, this is not exactly one-to-one correspondence. You think about like masochistic relations. When the person asks for violence in a way, because it's pleasurable. In this case, it's the student required violence from another person to some degree, pedagogical violence, but in order to study. So it's what I call auto-paternalism. And if you look at that from Bakhtinian point of view, in my view, it's only sim-didact is a form of organization of the self-education that promotes Bakhtinian dialogue. It's easy to say why this number three, number four, and number five is not Bakhtinian form, because there are clearly well-defined roles there. And remember, one of the points of the Bakhtinian, from what I extracted from Bakhtinian dialogue, is about that exactly stripping all the roles from the people. The people become, as Bakhtin said, man and man, or person and person. So the stripping roles. Here, the roles are well-defined and rather stable. And that's one reason. But there are many other reasons. One reason, like, for example, in this Adigas deduct, it's self-education with the teacher. If you look about, for example, dialogue of Socrates with Meno, initially there is a struggle going on between Meno as a student, in a way, who came to Socrates for help. Meno wanted to know origin of virtue. By the way, that dialogue was very important and politically important. Because it sounds esoteric for us, but in ancient Greece, in Athens, that was a very important ontological question. And the reason for that, Meno was belonging to kind of aristocratic family in Athens. And the question was, if virtues are inborn, in this case, democracy is not the best political organization for the Athens to have. Is if virtues can be taught, actually in this case, democracy can be good for the Athens. So the discussion was very important. But Socrates, from Socrates' point of view, this question is not interesting, because the question of what is virtue is more interesting than what's the whether or not virtue can be taught or not taught. And there is a fight between them going on for a while. And then suddenly, at some point, Socrates realized, wait a minute, you came to me. I need to stay focus on you. We're not consciousness with equal rights, in a way. Because you came to me for help. And I'm your teacher, and you're my student. And because of that, I need to accept your inquiry and not mine. In reality, Socrates was not exactly, he was, I argue, rather manipulative person, at least how Plato portrayed him. And he finally led Meno to his inquiry, but that's another story. My point is that It's really not a Bakhtinian dialogue there because of these roles of the teacher and the student. Now, autodidact, I argue, is also not a good, and this is actually Socrates can be very helpful. He very much criticized dialogue with the text, and he said that in the text, the author of the text and the reader do not have, again, consciousness with equal rights. While, because for many different reasons, one reason is that, you know, the reader can ask questions and the author cannot reply. Of course, the reader can imagine how author might reply, but that's not the the kind of dialogue that Bakhtinian dialogue, what he was talking about. It's very different one. And also self-dialogue is not the same as dialogue with real people. Again, I can go on and on about that, but that is, this is kind of a part of this. For that, it may be now, if you have a question, I can elaborate on that. So let me return back to the, yeah. Another very important thing about this pedagogical regime of Bakhtinian dialogue is presenting self in dialogue. This is interesting notions of presenting selves in dialogue developed by David Sabe very recently in his dissertation. You see, 2000, I was on his dissertation committee and I really get very excited about notions that he developed. Basically, this idea is that, that, you know, in the modern dialogues that happen, people kind of develop a very deontologize. They try to deontologize themselves. They talk about in general. They're not taking about responsibility for what they're saying or the examples that they're bringing or people that they're bringing into the dialogue. And this is a very, he provided, in my paper that I wrote for this, I provided his, a big make a big quote with his permission from David Sabe in his paper about this presenting selves in the dialogue. When the people become responsible for what they say, in other words, rather than creating these abstractions, theoretisms that Bakhtin was talking about, and not claiming responsibility for what they're saying, in a way. And it's very kind of common in the modern dialogue. And kind of the last point that I want to make, it's about this notion of agora, where people can, where is many Socratic dialogues happen in agora, but not only Socratic, there is many other you can find, like Plato to some degree, but also dialogue, I forgot what's, there's another school of Greek schools that were happening in the Agora when the philosophers were coming and dialoguing with each other, and everyone can join to them at any point and can leave at any point. Also, there was a lot of other activities was in the, it was embedded in the market. There was a market there. There was, also, there was government was part of the Athenian government was happening there. There was religious or part of the was there. So there is it's very this hetero discursia. If you think about in the in terms of the different practices and different spheres of lives. Were combining there, and people can come and join and leave and eavesdrop there. And this is, as I said, about this educational regime of the Bakhtinian dialogue. And attraction to this, Bakhtin mentioned about this attraction to this agora, when things happen, rather than a purified environment, which is usually, let's say, if you think about education, that's usually tried as purified as much as possible. So the students will not be distracted, right? This is a completely opposite idea that people can come and go in any time, and people of different of walks of life in this very open space. So this is my conclusion. If I have a conclusion, I have not reached a conclusion, I have questions. So my question is to the people who are really attracted to this notion of Bakhtinian dialogue. And the question is, should they commit after this? I'm trying to kind of explore. This is my provocations in a way. This is not a conclusion, that more like provocations for my colleagues who are interested in Bakhtinian dialogue. So should be educationists be committed to Bakhtinian dialogue? Should be they compete fully, partially, under what conditions, or if not, to what else? And so this is one type of the questions that I want to ask. So in a way, is it Bakhtinian dialogue compatible with education? This is like if you shorten my question. Also, should educational Bakhtinian educational dialogic educationists fully commit to the educational regime of the Bakhtinian dialogue, fully or partially, under what conditions and to what or to what else, if not to that? And my another question is. this kind of a conclusion that intrinsic pluralism of Bakhtinian dialogue and its educational regime. because in a way, this is very important, like if we return a little bit back to the self-education. Self-education does not necessarily need to be within Bakhtinian dialogue. It could be very instrumental, and it could be non-Bakhtinian in the nature of self-education. Bakhtinian can be only part of that. But in my view, Bakhtinian philosophy is very pluralistic in nature. It's not trying to purify itself and say that it should be just, everything should be that at that level of this Bakhtinian dialogue. And this is kind of interesting point that kind of I start thinking about intrinsic pluralism of Bakhtinian dialogue and its educational regime. And so I'm opening up for your thoughts. What do you think? And one more thing, that my paper should be somehow available, and I don't know how this, because I send it to the organizer of the conference. Thank you.
Спасибо большое. Спасибо большое, Юджин. Вопросы, пожалуйста. Please, your questions to our speaker. Сергей Сандлер.
Да. Большое спасибо, во-первых. I'll switch to English. I'll translate myself as well. So first of all, thank you very much. I had, and how are you doing, by the way? I had two purely technical remark, and one really more general question or possibly critique to follow them. So the more technical points, you were speaking about the dialogue between reader and text as not exactly being the Bakhtinian kind of dialogue, which Bakhtin explicitly disagreed with. Bakhtin explicitly spoke about this as dialogue, full-fledged. not in the Dostoevsky book, but definitely in other texts. So that's one point. Another point about interest is taken seriously, but not quite love. Just to also to like avoid some sort of clashes of terms. Bakhtin had a very specific use for the word serious. For Bakhtin, being serious is being partial, not partial in the sense of like being partial to something, but being partial is not being whole. Anything serious has to be supplemented by laughter to reach a full picture. Bakhtin, and again, this is something he wrote explicitly in several places. So taken seriously is not the wording Bakhtin would have used, for his own good reasons. And about love, this is a philosophical term with a long pedigree, going back to Empedocles, at least. It is the central term in Matvey Kagan's philosophy of history. So when Bakhtin uses the term love, and he uses the term love, as Carol rightly noted yesterday, it has probably a precise meaning, though we can't tell for sure, because he uses the term very sparingly in very specific places, almost cryptically. And there's a lot of subtext behind it. So love, when Bakhtin uses the term, and in a Bakhtinian context, is a significant issue, and not exactly your everyday understanding of love, in a sense. And to the more general point, I get the impression that you are, maybe because you're focusing specifically on dialogue in the Dostoevsky book, which is one aspect of the issue for Bakhtin, your notion of authorship is a bit romanticized. Your notion of freedom is a bit more Sartrean than Bakhtinian, because you consistently set aside the aspect of authorship that has to do with being entirely, through and through, dependent on others. For Bakhtin, an author, he puts it that way, an author is not a composer. He's a conductor, like an orchestra conductor, right? He's not the font and origin of the authored work directly. He is the creator of the work in the sense that he arranges and interprets the voices of others that make it up. But he has no voice of his own, other than what he does with the voices of others. So those were my points. Do you want me to translate to Russian first before you answer, Eugene?
Yes, please. it will be nice if you say it in Russian spell rather than.
Значит, мой вопрос такой. Ну, вернее, не вопрос, два, во-первых, технических, так сказать, уточнения. Во-первых, диалог автора с читателем по Бахтину полноценнейший диалог, он это пишет прямо, непосредственно, во многих местах. Правда, действительно, не настолько в книге о Достоевском. По поводу интереса как серьезного отношения, to take somebody serious, значит, к серьезно к кому-то относиться. У Бахтина, конечно, понятие серьезности имеет намного более уточненное значение. Таким словом, как серьезность, он бы просто так не бросался, скажем так. Конечно, у вас понимание серьезности не то, что у Бахтина в данном случае, но нужно учесть, когда говорим в бахтинском контексте. То же самое по поводу любви. У Бахтина любовь – это термин длинной истории, в общем-то, восходящей уже к Эмпедоклу, но и очень важно восходящей к Матвею Кагану, у которого любовь – это самый центральный термин его философии и истории. И когда Бахтин пользуется термином «любовь», он им пользуется, то у этого особое значение. И, наконец, так сказать, последнее более принципиальное возражение, я бы сказал. У меня такое впечатление, что у вас понимание авторства, видимо, под влиянием именно книги о Достоевском, но нет других текстов, понимание авторства несколько романтизированное. и понимание свободы несколько, ну, плакатные экзистенциалисты, пасайфтеры, скажем так. Извините за слово плакатное, ну, немножко, так сказать, рисковато получилось, но я надеюсь, вы мне поверите. В том смысле, что в отличие от Бахтина, вы не подчеркиваете глубочайший долг, который любой автор по Бахтину должен другим. Для Бахтина, как он сам писал в одном месте, автор, он не композитор, автор, он всего лишь дирижер. Всего лишь он дирижер. Он создатель. Он создатель интерпретации. Но у него нет своего голоса. У него есть голоса других, которые он расставляет, с которыми он работает. Он не просто оригинатор. Он не в точке начала. Вот. Это были мои вопросы и возражения. Ну, пожалуйста.
Спасибо большое, Сергей. Я сначала отвечу по-русски, а потом по-английски, если можно. I will answer first in Russian and then in English. Мой ответ вам, Сергей. Меня, конечно, больше всего интересует образование, а не Бахтин в целом, потому что я исхожу отсюда. Хотя Бахтин тоже интересует. Это как, я, может быть, сразу же не согласен. А? То есть иногда меня больше интересует образование, иногда больше интересует Бахтин. Иногда, то есть это все меняется. Вот. Что я хочу вам сказать. Я с вами, с одной стороны, согласен, с другой стороны, конечно, не согласен. Согласен я вот с чем. Для меня, моего прочтения Бахтина, я как бы вижу много Бахтиных и в Бахтине. И в разное время он менялся и прямо уходил и становился противофазой к самому себе. А потом это тоже менялось. И это очень интересно. И это не минус его, а плюс. Минус его в том, что он, мне кажется, был бы более интересный, если бы он об этом прямо и говорил, что я взял и ушел отсюда, передумал, пересмотрел и так далее. Было бы очень интересно знать. Если бы он присутствовал на нашей конференции, я бы его с удовольствием спросил бы этот вопрос, как вот он менялся за свою жизнь и почему. Вы абсолютно правы, что для меня в центральной книге, вот в этом сейчас, в моем презентации, да, по-русски сказать, в этой презентации самое главное играло, конечно, книга о Достоевском. Это вы правы, конечно. И более того, я, на мой взгляд, он и ранние его работы, и поздние его работы противоречат книге Достоевском. Поэтому для меня существует много Бахтиных. Вот. И то, что вы сказали, резонирует с другими Бахтинами, которые менее, для меня лично менее интересны, по крайней мере, сейчас. Вот те Бахтины, о которых вы говорите. Меня, вы абсолютно правы, меня больше интересует Бахтин в книге о Достоевском. В книгах о Достоевском, поскольку вообще это как бы две книги, и они не совсем одинаковые. Вот. Теперь, что я хотел сказать еще, что значит, во-первых, много Бахтиных существует. Что-то я вот за... Вот вы сказали очень важное, я хотел ответить, чего-то я забыл. Давайте я начну переводить на английский язык, а потом я вспомню, что я, собственно, хотел вам еще ответить. Поэтому... А, да-да-да-да, очень важно. Очень важную вещь вы сказали, и мне нужно уточнить. Вы видите, сразу перевели в диалог между автором и героями. А я абсолютно... Меня не интересует в моем презентации диалог между автором и героями.
Читателем,
да. Я фокусируюсь полностью на, так сказать, героях Достоевского. То есть на его, на бахтинском анализе героев Достоевского. То есть у меня внутри героев Достоевского. Напряжение все внутри героев Достоевского. И это как бы, я не знаю, как русское слово, гайдит меня. В общем, это меня направляет. Меня, не то что даже, вдохновляет меня это. Да, вот слово «вдохновляет» – очень хорошее слово. Меня именно это и вдохновляет, а не взаимоотношения. И, на мой взгляд, вы правы, что он говорил там о диалоге, допустим, автора и героя и так далее. Но для меня вот тот Бахтин, который писал о Достоевском, мне кажется, он рассматривал все вот эти диалоги как не настоящий диалог. Диалог настоящий, вот опять, мое прочтение, конечно, книги Достоевского, его книгах о Достоевском, две книги, говорит о том, что вот как бы в этот момент Бахтин, мне кажется, думал, что, что настоящий диалог, вот этот диалог, который по максимуму, он возможен только между реальными людьми, живыми людьми. То есть в этом плане как бы вот Сократа, возражение Сократа против текстуальности, что именно что диалог невозможен с текстом, а только возможен с живыми людьми. И мне кажется, вот, ну, это мое прочтение Бахтина такое, оно может быть очень спорное. Вот, то есть я такое сократовское прочтение Бахтина. Если бы Сократ прочитал Бахтина, Сократ вроде как не читал, но если бы он знаком был, то вот это мое прочтение, это ответ вам. Теперь я постараюсь перевести, конечно, я забыл, что я сказал. Вот в этом как раз меня интересно. Важная вещь, что я был выращен моей бабушкой, которая была неграмотная. И поэтому вот я вырос в оральной культуре. И поэтому для меня важны живые люди. Текст – это все такая, в некотором смысле, мертвечина. Вот. Опять, разный Бахтин, мне кажется, разный Бахтин согласен был. Иногда он был согласен с этим, а иногда был не согласен с этим. Особенно поскольку он был как бы и... Как философ, я думаю, что он был согласен, а как вот филолог или, может быть, литературный критик, он, наверное, был бы не согласен. И в разное время, по-разному, мне кажется, по этому поводу думал. Вот. Но это, может быть, я и не прав по этому поводу. Может быть, это отсебятина моя, вот, за которую я несу ответственность. Вот. Let me translate that, and I don't know whether or not it's possible for me to translate, because I'm a very oral person. So my reply to Sergei, and thanks Sergei for this very important comments, that I'd like to remember what I just said in Russian. Please correct me if I'm wrong. First of all, for me, the focus is not on dialogue of author and character or reader. But for me, I'm focusing on the Bakhtinian dialogues of the characters in the Dostoevsky's novels. That's for me the guiding force to define the dialogue and Bakhtinian analysis of dialogue of the characters. That's very different. And in my view, this is where the at least that is what important for me. To think about in situation in education. And in my view, Bakhtin changed his mind all the time, and he was very different in different writings. And Sergei is absolutely right that I'm mostly focused on his books on Dostoevsky, and this is where this is what enforced me. And I'm much more attracted to that rather than to other his work and other Bakhtin's ideas, some of which contradict to this book on Dostoevsky. Now I'm thinking about what else I need to say. Yeah, and this is also very important that what's interesting, what inspirational for me is not so much Bakhtin, like the dialogue of the author and the character or dialogue of the readers, but it's a character, Dostoevsky's characters, primary focus for me. And in this case, and this is maybe my fantasy, but I think in this book on Dostoevsky, Bakhtin will define dialogue only with two or more life's consciousnesses. Not through the between a life consciousness and the text or even internal dialogue. I think in his analysis, internal dialogue is often represents excessive dialogism, which is a form of monologism. Again, Bakhtin changed his mind all the time, and it was very interesting too. There are, for me, there are many Bakhtins. And it's what Sergei said, I can recognize, and I think it's a very valid point that he's making, but it's not my Bakhtins that I'm talking about. And this is different Bakhtins, which is, it doesn't mean that they're wrong Bakhtins, it's just like they're not, other Bakhtins much less resonate in me, at least right now. And I was coming from more oral culture. I was raised by my illiterate grandmother. And for me, orality is the, I'm much close to Socrates, who saw any text as killing of the dialogue. And I also think that internal dialogue, and again, in the book of Bakhtins, you will see how internal dialogue, it's almost excessive, what Bakhtin would talk about, excessive dialogism, which is a form of monologism. So maybe this is extreme views, but this is how I see dialogue again. And Sergei is absolutely right that I'm guided by the book, two books by Bakhtin about Dostoevsky, and not his later work so much, and not early work. Although they're important for me as well, but not as kind of in the center of. Thank you.
Спасибо. Там есть еще вопрос Серхио.
Серхио, пожалуйста. Серхио Маздиас.
Да. Thanks a lot for your exposé. It was very interesting. I've been following your work for some years already. And I had two questions. One related to what you were talking today. And another one related to an article, a chapter of you that I like a lot. Culture has no internal territory. It's a chapter you wrote for the Cambridge Handbook. And then I know it's a little old, but I found there a couple ideas very interesting. One of them I want you to ask is this notion of Creole communities. I think it's very inspiring. Мне тоже вдохновляет, but this notion, because it's a good way to overcome essentialism. That's a very specific question. And then one more general. The examples that gives Bakhtin from Dostoevsky or from the dialogues of Socrates are between adult people. And your theory, I like it, insofar as related to adult education also. But I see a lot of problems in applying it to children education. I think that there is a gap there. Your ideas about giving the voice to the student, let him choose the topics or the right to interrupt, all this can be done between adults. But my own experience is that it's much more complicated with, let's say, teenagers. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Сергей.
Я быстренько на русском. Я соглашусь, и следующую вашу работу уже давно, и мне очень интересует и как философ, и тоже как педагог. Я сам тоже преподавал языках в разных местах, и вот этот вопрос интеркультуры мне очень близко. И я вспоминаю публику, что у вас были очень интересные главы на Cambridge Handbook of Sociocultural Psychology, как раз как использует идея Бакхтина, что нет boundaries внутри культуры, как это идея культура диалога, и вы там показали некоторые примеры, о котором я сейчас спросил, говорит больше. А потом второй вопрос, более обширный. Ваши примеры, как и примеры Бакхтина, Достоевского или сам Сократа, всегда касаются взрослые люди. И тоже артикл Канта имеет в виду взрослые люди, как раз они просят этих взрослых людей, чтобы они не остался как миндерверты. Вот он на немецкий там сказал, что пожалуйста, начинайте думать сами себе. Это то, что Кант писал в такой момент. И сейчас я вижу здесь на чате тоже коллега вспоминает Рансьер. Рансьер тоже использует примеры из взрослых людей, которые учатся после работы самому. Очень интересная книга. Но я думаю, что это не касается детьми. Вот это моя два вопроса. Спасибо.
Thank you, Sergio. Let me start with the second one, and then please guide me to go to the back to the first one. I noticed that one problem with aging, what I called my memory become mature, and that's the problem. It's mature memory. In terms of the question of this mature memory coming to the point, I'm good illustrator of that mature memory.
Adult versus children. That was
Part of that, in my view, complexity of the education, because not so much complexity of the education, it's almost like education, when we're talking about education practice, in my view, especially with the relating to the children, it's mixed up with so many other concerns with it, in general, nothing to do with education. And of course, if you're going to the real kind of real schools. By the way, the word school, it's, the Greek word school means leisure. And this is, if you think about school, modern schools, it's anything but leisure. It's so much away from leisure. It's such a нудное, I'm using this, and скучное времяпрепровождение, and very also very violent. There is a lot of pedagogical violence going on, and not only pedagogical. But if you think about education, including children's education, from the point of view of just a little bit purify that and think about as education itself, from the Greek, ancient Greek words as a form of leisure, suddenly, all of these concerns that Kantian concern. By the way, Kant was not only concerned about children; he primarily was concerned actually about adults. They are not ready for dialogue. That they are not ready for freedom. They need to be they're not ready for autonomy. They need to be constrained first, and then when they're ready, the freedom and dialogue will be offered to them. But before that, that's what paternalism is about, educational paternalism. And in my view, if you think about children, and especially type of education that's called democratic education, and again, I'm not sure the term is good, and the people in that education also not sure that it's the term is democratic education, is good, and I specifically want to, I'm referring to such institutions as Summerhill or Sudbury Valley School in Summerhill is Great Britain, that just celebrating 100 years of existence. It's a private school, and Sudbury Valley School is a school in United States, which is almost like 50 years in existence, I think a little bit more than that. And there are many others around the world. And that type of school, they are not based on paternalism, or their paternalism is much less. So then, and they actually reject Kantian paternalism. That's what's most important. And where they're not necessarily dialogic, and not necessarily dialogic in a Bakhtinian sense, but deeply down they are. This is what my observation and argument is. Sometimes despite of monologism of the some of the founders of that schools, they had, because they have that spirit, they're recreating a little bit agora in their sense, which is a very, in my view, a dialogic chronotope in its essence. And that's why I think, and they show that, I don't know if you visited this type of democratic schools, I did a lot. And one thing that admires, the first like shocking things is how dialogic the students are. By the way, in some cases, they're much more dialogic than their staff, because they don't like to be called teachers. There, but the staff, they're much more dialogue. And this is very exciting and interesting situation. So I think this is, can be applied to the education at different levels. But important things that if you think about traditional education and even progressive education, it's so much driven by Kantian pedagogical paternalism, that in a way it's difficult for us to imagine how else it can be. That's one thing. And another way, it's so much suppress students' consciousness that it's almost like feels like they are not capable of doing that because of that socialization of them is in these monologic regimes of the schooling, conventional schooling and some, especially progressive innovative schooling, which is better than conventional, but still.
And can you say a couple of words about this idea of Creole communities?
Creole communities, yes. And this is, Creole communities, it's not, it's kind of a perspective on the communities, on the Dalajim, rather than seeing a community as something uniting, something that people have in common. It's a common community, is the same root. It's reverse thing, seeing differences inside of that. And creolization, which means this different, it's a medium where the difference are allowed and promoted to exist. And so when the difference is important. And if you, again, look at the, all these enlightenment projects, especially in education, the kind of focus is how to get consensus at the end of that. Like it, that's Kantian kind of things as well. It's not nothing new in a way. For him, it's kind of rational dialogue. It's not, it's temporary thing. Then people came to consensus and that's it. But this is... this is a different thing that creolization, it's just like, it's a conceptual view on the difference. It's just one of the, and the difference as something that is permanent and valuable. It's something that the consciousness are not transparent about opaque, and they always will remain opaque. They're not like 100% opaque, but essentially opaque, which is, means that this opaqueness will never disappear. And that's great news. It's not bad news. It's not, I know that from kind of enlightenment mind, it's kind of bad news because for them getting in the kind of global mind, global rational mind, that's will be kind of a goal of the absolute spirit, like in terms of the Hegel.
Yeah.
What they find. So this is kind of opposite to that. There is no absolute spirit. It's, that's why the difference, there is absolute difference, an essential difference.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Спасибо большое, Юджин. Но к вам еще один вопрос. Анна Марьянович Шейн. хочет задать вам вопрос.
Hi. Thank you very much for all these wonderful questions and answers, and of course the presentation. And I was inspired by Sergei's talk about the notion of author. So I'd like to ask a question. I think that the using the word author in education it has a different sense than using it in the realm of art or literature, where in the art and literature you think of an author, let's say, how I would decide, define in the focus is that that person arranges certain kind of new practice or new thinking, where something new grows out of that, and they have this bringing into the world something that didn't exist before. Maybe I'm wrong, but I just want to generalize. But the focus of the word author is the person who is making things. And I think in education, and I want to ask Eugene, the focus of the word author is more, again, political, is a person who has a legitimate right to do this arrangement of the things. Mm-hmm. And that's my question, just very simple.
Mm-hmm.
I cannot translate into Russian, so please, somebody else translate for me.
Okay, you can translate in Serbian.
Yeah, it won't help other people.
Another Slavic language.
Вопрос касается разницы в понимании авторства, понимания автора в области литературы, искусства с одной стороны и в области вот педагогики с другой стороны, да, то есть в чем различие этого понятия автор?
Спасибо большое, Анна. Я сначала отвечу по-русски, а потом по-другому отвечу, наверное, по-английски. По-русски, значит, когда идеи Бахтина стали как бы переводиться в образование, часто автор был это учитель, а ученики, они, ну, герои. Ну, вот Тимоти Лэнсмайер, например, это у него была такая статья очень интересная и очень программная статья в 90-х годах. И он вот стал развивать эту идею. И Кио Миядзаки, который присутствует на нашей конференции, но, по-моему, он из Японии, поскольку я думаю, что он присутствует на утренних заседаниях, утренних в России, а не на вечерних, потому что у него сейчас глубокая ночь, наверное. Жалко, что у него не присутствует. Вот он тоже выдвигал такие идеи. С моей точки зрения, автор – это как раз прежде всего это герои. Но опять, это потому что я перевожу на язык образования, то есть студенты. Самый главный автор в образовании – это студент, а не учитель. Учитель, он второстепенен, да, и он совсем не автор образования. Автор образования является студент. Я не знаю, кто сейчас говорит. Ага. Так вот, значит, действительно разницы в этом плане есть, и среди вот людей, которые интересуются образованием, я не знаю, есть ли слово одно, которое в русском языке educationalist, я не знаю, как его перевести. Вот, идутся споры об этом, кто является автором образования. Значит, или это считается учитель. А я считаю, что это не учитель, а это как раз ученик, ученики, учащиеся, я не знаю, как лучше сказать по-русски. Вот, и они являются авторами своего собственного образования. А если посмотреть на учителя, он автор помощи, но не автор образования. И он, учитель всегда второстепенен, и существует образование без учителя, и оно, вот я как раз хотел сказать, что дух бахтинского диалога, если перевести в образование, это не иметь учителей. а иметь как бы, то есть когда нет устойчивой роли, то есть это некоторое такое собрание, диалог среди учеников, у которых, которые в разное время динамически становятся учителями друг за друга и для себя тоже. Но там нету устойчивых никаких ролей студент или, или учитель. Это моя такая точка зрения, которая не все с этим согласны. Это как бы бахтинское понимание, на мой взгляд. Опять, мой перевод Бахтина в образование. Окей, let me translate, if it can be called translated, not another speech, which might be different from Russian. So my reply to Anna is very, I really appreciate her point, because when Бахтин was translated into Russian, into education, I'm sorry, into education in the... these ideas of Бахтина were translated like that the teacher is the author and students are characters. And specifically, Timothy Lenzmeyer and Kiyo Miyazaki from Japan, who is actually part of this conference, but I'm afraid he's, for him it's night right now, and that he's not here with us, unfortunately. And my approach is very different, as Anna pointed out, and our approach, Anna, I think, would agree with that, that we see the primary authors are students, not the teacher. Teacher is also author, but it's the authorship of the teacher is to help the authorship of the students to author their own education. The education, essentially, it's self-education from this point of view. And there is tensions in the field of education about that. And I think it's a very productive tension. And but it's important difference. The primary author of education, from my point of view, it is students themselves, and not the teacher. Thank you.
Спасибо большое. У нас есть желающие прокомментировать ваш доклад. Прежде всего, это Тина Хёг. Она хочет прокомментировать. Tina Hoek wants to comment your speech.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me?
Yes, okay. Yes, I can hear you.
Hello, Jean. Nice to see you. I just wanted to comment exactly, and you said it right now, I think, the difference between the students as characters and students as authors. I think you asked, can we as educators go all in for to be dialogic? And I think the reason why the Dostoevsky book is very important to educators is that it sort of gives us it's sort of a meta language. To see and to show also for the students that this is what is happening. This is the novel. This is that they actually have a voice, and it's an active voice, and that they the voices in voices also that they get aware. The students get aware that they use each other's voices. Not only the teachers. It's not the teacher's script, but the important thing for educators, and that's makes it very important for the students as well, is that we get this meta notion of this is what actually going on, and we have to be active to turn the voices into authors and not being characters, because I think that's the point of changing this authorship and make them aware that they have that challenge, and it's theirs, as you say. Thank mm-hmm. you. I cannot translate to Russian. I'm sorry. I hope you can.
Спасибо. Кто отвечает? Юджин?
Окей. Вы не могли бы перевести по-русски?
Ну, скажем так, в комментарии дана была высокая оценка роли книги Бахтина о Достоевском для педагогического процесса и для педагогической практики современной. И одновременно была дана высокая оценка докладу профессора Матусова, если говорить коротко, не вдаваясь в большие подробности для русского читателя. Если можно, Женя, я тоже позволю себе реплику. Тайна Косовский, я очень рад вас видеть в добром здравии. Спасибо за прекрасный доклад. Я бы добавил, что это как раз вот тот замечательный пример, с одной стороны, полифонического Бахтина в пространстве образования, который вы продемонстрировали, да, разные взгляды Бахтина на разные вещи, в разные периоды, все равно сходящиеся к чему-то общему и понятному для нас, для всех. И это то, что как раз вот о чем говорили Джейн Уайт с автором, да, Read Bakhtin Educationally. Это вот еще один прекрасный пример того, как вот можно и нужно читать Бахтина. А вторая моя реплика касается как раз вот этой вашей мысли о учащемся, обучающемся, как об авторе, и я думаю, что она понравится всему педагогическому сообществу, потому что, как мы знаем, у Бахтина есть вот это сочетание автор и герой, которое неразрывно, оно не будет никогда удалено из нашего сознания, как оно не будет никогда удалено из наследия Бахтина. И, соответственно, если мы отдаем роль автора обучающемуся, то учителю остается роль героя. Я думаю, что это приятно всем тем, кто учит. Еще раз спасибо за замечательный доклад.
А вы не могли бы перевести сами себя на английский?
Okay. First of all, Eugene's report is a vivid and perfect example of the process that Professor White and her co-author called reading Bakhtin educationally. And it's a vivid example of, let us say so, polyphonic Bakhtin with his different views on different things at different times, and all the same, the whole Bakhtin, or Bakhtin as a whole, with his many voices, many views that can be used in educational process. That's the first thing. And the second thing is Eugene's idea that our students is the real author. And so, as we know, this dichotomy by Bakhtin, the author and the hero, leaves the teacher only one role, the role of a hero. And I think it's a good compliment to all those who teaches their students. Thank you.
Спасибо большое. Теперь мы переходим к следующему докладу. Наш следующий доклад – это доклад Светланы Анатольевны Дубровской под названием «Бахтинская энциклопедия.